Boris Cousins from the Pacific Sámi Searvi. It's Katie Greenland, board member of the Pacific Sámi Searvi in the United States. I'm here in Venice, Italy at the Biennale Arte 2022. It's an international art festival that happens every 2 years. This year is very special for a couple of reasons. I want to introduce a couple of guests to you here at the Sámi Pavilion in the Biennale. Mayan Gop Sandberg is from Kautokeino. And Elamari Dunfield Oskom, also from Kautokeino. Both of these young women have traveled a long way from their home to be part of the Sámi Pavilion to act as cultural bridge builders and to help other people understand Sámi culture, history, art, ways of life. So I'm very excited that they offered to share with you today a conversation and a tour of the art and history that is right here in the Sámi Pavilion at the Biennale.
Yeah, welcome to the Sámi Pavilion. We have three Sámi artists here, and we would like to start with Marhana Sara.
Marhana Sara's exhibition consists of three installations, and it is created in the aftermath of a 7-year-long battle against the Norwegian state. Because they wanted her family, specifically her brother, to reduce the amount of reindeer he had in his herd, which would make it very hard, impossible, to live off reindeer herding. And so through these works, it's kind of a healing process after the trauma that they have experienced. Here, she has used reindeer stomachs, they are dried, and this is the inside. And so in our gut, in our stomachs, we feel our emotions, our biggest emotions. And each of the stomachs represents someone who has caused trauma to the family during these years of the legal battle, and through these stomachs she transfers back to these people that they represent the trauma that they have caused the family. This piece, here you can see three reindeer calves, red calves, and it represents birth and death and hope and fear. And these reindeer calves have died of natural causes, and it also represents the imbalance of how the state has made laws that make it hard for the reindeer herders. One of the examples is the imbalance of predators and prey. Mm-hmm. And these are the grass around, it's there as protection. These we use in our shoes or in our traditional footwear to keep us dry and warm. And the cotton grass, what it's called, it represents hope. Mm. So this is all organic material, and it represents the Sámi ethics. Using everything.
Mm-hmm. Incredible.
Yes.
If you can get the scope of this, the piece itself is a good 3 feet taller than a tall grown man. So it's quite tall, it's suspended from the ceiling. So you get a chance to see it from a 360 degree view, which is absolutely incredible.
It's made to spin. It's because it represents the spiral. Life and death.
Wow.
And she has another.
And these are the third piece that Marhana Sara has. She has been using sinews from reindeer to make this piece.
And we also use, the Sami people use sinews to make threads, so we have like this practical dimension of it as well. And these sinews, this piece is called Fear, and it contains a smell. Unfortunately, you can't smell it through the camera, but we can give you some samples of the smell that you can bring back.
You can also try to smell it and maybe explain how it smells to you.
Yeah. So it for those of you in the United States who have smelled reindeer, it smells like a hide or maybe like a drum that I've seen or felt before. It's very familiar smells.
So it represents actually fear, and it is, as you say, the smell consists of reindeer, but it's collected from the ground where reindeer have been stressed or afraid. Also, there's some fuel.
Oil,
yeah, in there.
And Narhan Sara is showing how reindeer and also the Sami people communicate the fear that they feel when they're being colonized, when the area has been taken and the land has been taken away. And in this case, this is from a memory that she has together with her father, because her father was always this comforting man, very protective, and as a kid she wanted to go with him when he was brought to the police office for questioning. Because in their summer grazing lands, there had been some reindeer eating flowers from this cabin, and this was not something the owner of this cabin liked. So it was they had to go to the police office for questioning, and she insisted to go with him.
Wow.
And she can remember how her father, that usually was this calm man, he changed. He felt fear and his scent also, his smell also changed. Mm-hmm. And this is something that the reindeer also do when they are feeling stressed.
If you try to smell it with your nose in it, you can really feel the sting of the... It's a strong smell. She's worked together with a perfumer in Mexico to make this smell, and they spray it on the piece every week to have it.
How would you describe this, the smell of this piece, Mayan?
It's kind of smells, if you go like around it, it's less of an intense smell, but when you go into it, like with your nose in it, it's almost like stinging your nose. It's like pee or you know, like what the reindeer give off, I don't know.
So perhaps the smell of this piece is more meant to be experienced and difficult to describe. So maybe some of you can make your way to the Biennale. It's open until November, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's open here in Venice until November.
So this is the second piece in this installation. The other one was Fear, and this is Hope. And when you smell this, you can smell it's a much more round smell and more comfortable. And it consists of the artist's, Marhan Sara's, own breast milk, the milk of reindeer, the scent of a reindeer calf, and also from sweetgrass and plants in the tundra. So you mentioned that we had an experience of a baby coming in here crying, and then when they got close to this, the baby went quiet. Mm-hmm. So it is a comforting smell.
These sinews are from different reindeer than the piece called Fear?
Yes, it could be. because from the other one, on the fear one, the reindeer that has been going through stress, and they release this kind of smell in the other one. So I can imagine she's been using reindeer that have been stressed to make the fear one, and the other reindeer to make this one.
Mm-hmm. Also, you can notice when a reindeer has been stressed, when it's been slaughtered
and cooked. If you cook it, it doesn't taste well good.
So it tastes differently if it was stressed out when it was
slaughtered. Yes.
And you can taste the difference.
Yeah, you can smell it, then you can taste it, and it's really not good.
Wow, that's fascinating.
But so this is, it represents that there is hope for the future, and you need hope to continue
these battles.
Yes.
Well, it's the hope and the joy that you feel for this tribe, and it is remaining hopeful, the Sámi people, of course, to...
Yeah. This whole thing is a healing.
Yeah.
She is a Sámi artist, Paulina Ferdero, from the Finnish side of Sámi. She is a performing artist, and she has been here at the Pavillion having a performance, and she will come back again in August.
Oh, wow.
And she has two screens here that show different content.
First one shows like bits from the performances she's been having here together with other Sámi artists. And Paulina, she is an artist but also a land protector, a land guardian. So these videos show how she and her family and other people in these areas protect the lands and also restoring the rivers and the land that has been destroyed. So the Finnish government, they are selling these lands and industrializing these lands.
Oh wow, that's awful.
And she is
raising money and awareness with this slogan, "Don't buy our lands, buy our art instead." So she is hoping that some museum perhaps, some bigger institutions or some art collectors would buy these images from these videos, so she could buy back these lands for the Sámi people.
I see. So this is a land buyback effort. Yes. And it says, "Don't buy our land, buy our art instead." I wonder if you could tell us, where can Sámi Americans go to... Ah, that's right. Before I came here, if you just Google the Biennale in Venice and you Google the Sámi Pavilion, there you will be able to read descriptions of each of the pieces and the bio of each of the artists. And there you can find contact information to support each of the artists in here in the Sámi Pavilion.
And so she wants to let these ancestral Sámi forests and lands and rivers give them time to grow and prosper again after the destruction they have that has been inflicted.
Right.
So she also has this initiative with whoever buys her art, they will be able to visit the land every 5 years, as I understand it. Yes, to see how what you have been a part of rescuing. Yes.
So it sounds like with her installation, with her piece, she's inviting almost a relationship to come back, to see the land, how it's been stewarded, how it's been cared for.
The last artist we're going to talk about is Andish Sunna. He comes from a forest reindeer herding family on the Swedish side of Sápmi. And here you can see six pieces that show a 50-year-long battle, also a battle again. Against the Swedish state this time.
They come from the area where he and his family has the reindeer.
Uh-huh.
And they have been built by him and his brothers. These
installations,
yes.
These panels.
Okay.
And so, before we you go on the photos, pictures, there are binders between each picture that contain over 1,000 documents of court cases, and everyone here is welcome to read.
Mm-hmm.
And on the QR code, you can have
short summaries that you can listen. So mm-hmm. you can also take the link and send it to you.
Yeah. So I'll send the QR code so that you can, for those of you in the US, you can listen to the description of each one of these six panels and learn more about the history of these court cases between Sámis and the Swedish state.
This is actually a story of one family in particular
that have been having their rights taken away from them. Each panel represents a decade and it's like a timeline. And the first one is from the 70s.
This one here.
Yes. In this, in 1971, the Swedish state passed on some new laws regarding the reindeer herding, and it made it really, really difficult for the Sámi people to practice reindeer herding as they had been doing the traditional way. There were a lot of complex laws, but basically the Swedish state wanted the Sámi reindeer herders to take care of the Swedish people's reindeer, the landowners' reindeer, for free.
Really?
And so that the Sámi people could then use these lands, even though they are Sámi lands. They are not owned by anyone, even though that are owned by the landowners, Swedish landowners.
I see. So the Swedish state wanted free labor.
Yes.
And care for their reindeer.
Yes. And there were a lot of Sami families that did this, but the Sunna family, they refused to do this. So that was like the beginning of these 50-year-old legal struggles against the state. So here we can see the imbalance between the Samis and the government representatives. This panel is representing the 80s. And here we see that the Swedish government came to, I'm pretty sure it was his grandfather that is laying here sick, and they came to and said that you have to go to court. We want to erase, to cancel your and your family's earmarks that you use to mark the reindeers.
These are earmarks.
Passed down through generations.
And there were a lot, these are like concrete episodes that has happened.
This is Anders Sunna's father and his brothers?
Yes.
Wow.
So there were a lot of demonstrations, and they were, because they didn't obey to this new law, they were made outlaws, criminalized in Sweden. They had to move. They didn't have the right to reindeer herding anymore, but they were keep having the reindeer, and they had to move the reindeer to other areas. And when they moved the reindeer, there were a lot of over 1,000 reindeer that went lost. And here the government representatives are depicted in uniforms that can remind of the Nazi uniforms. But they have this Swedish state symbol on their arm.
I see.
So I can imagine it's about the fear that they felt and how the government treated the Sunna family. And the next one is about the 80s. This was also the time when Anders Sunna was born. And this was the first time the Sunna family got their case to the court. And this man over here was the judge of this court case, and the Sunna family lost the court case. But after the judge like found out that this the Swedish state has also been not following their own laws, so he saw and realized how the Swedish state was treating the Sami people and the Sunna family, so he switched sides and became a lawyer for the Sunna family.
Wow.
And he's been working with the king since then. When the Sunna family was outlaws in Sweden, the civil society of Sweden also thought this, thought this way about the Sunna family. So they were sabotaging their work with the reindeer. They were setting fire to their cabins. There was this one incident, especially one incident, that was about their cabin being stolen and set fire on.
Hmm.
And they went to court with this, but they lost this case also, and the Sunna family had to pay for the costs.
Of the court case,
yes.
which can be very expensive.
And the Swedish government put up a fence
over 3 kilometers and they used a lot of resources, over 3 million Swedish kroners, to build this fence to keep the reindeer from these areas. And Anders Sunna, when he started school in the late 80s, he and his brothers had some teachers that also were these Swedish landowners, so they were against the Sunna family, and they gave them bad grades, and they were harassing these, and these were children at school age.
Wow, so the children were impacted as well.
Yes.
Because of the bias and discrimination of the Swedish state.
Yes.
Exactly.
And the Swedish people.
And they also experienced, as you can see an example of here, that a family member chose to take his own life because of the hardships that they were facing.
Wow.
So these are powerful stories.
Incredibly powerful and important to capture and to know and to remember so that history doesn't repeat itself, and to honor the people who said no and would not follow these new guidelines from the Swedish state and had to navigate the consequences of standing up for their rights and their land and their reindeer and their people.
So these were ongoing processes for a long time, and this is representing the 2000s. In 2006, there were some adjustments of these new laws, but basically it was the same. The Sunna family had this guerrilla way of practicing reindeer herding. They had to have fences that they could put down very quickly in case the police came, mm-hmm. because they were in areas that they had no right to be in, mm-hmm. In the state's point of view at least. So this was also an incident when they had to quickly move from the other side of the river to this side when the police came. They were being watched upon in the 2000s also.
And when you say they were being watched upon, what does that mean?
They didn't have the right to practice reindeer herding, so they were the police were after them all along.
And probably they felt that the society around them, as well, were keeping an eye on what they were doing.
But since this was in the forest areas, it was possible for the Sunna family to hide for the whole time.
The last standing panel here is from 2019. Here we can see the Swedish government in dialogue with the Sami parliament in Sweden. The Sami parliament doesn't have a real power, but they, the government is supposed to consult the Sami parliament in issues that affect the Sami people. And in this case, the Sami parliament agreed to cancel the earmarks.
And they agreed.
They agreed to
cancel the earmarks.
Yes.
And why did they agree?
That's remaining a question. Anders Sunna is depicting the Sami parliament as cowards, really, because they didn't go against the Swedish government. So they have they're holding this rabbit over here, which is like, yeah, you're scared as a rabbit.
Oh. So it sounds like there might have been some social conflict even between and among Sami people with how the Sami parliament handled this decision. Is that right?
Yeah, I think that was the issue, yes. Mm-hmm. Because also in the Sami society, there were some people considering the Sunna family as the bad Samis. Mm. And the families that obeyed to these laws were the good Samis. And because of their initiative to take this fight was something not everyone agreed on. So these are the representatives of the Sami parliament, and they are depicted as faceless. That could be about how they don't really, they don't take the fight against the, and supported the Sami reindeer herders in this case. So they are like only being showcased when the Sami people are like exotic and representatives of a great culture. Mm-hmm. That's quite common when the Nordic countries tell about these areas, tell about these Nordic lands. They usually show the Samis and their culture as their own. But when it comes to the Sami rights, they're not as supportive. Yes. But the Sunna family are remaining hopeful. You can see in this reindeer that has been going through a lot, you can see the faces of the generations that have been going through these battles and struggles. And they are being followed by calves and the children. So they are continuing this fight to get their rights back as reindeer holders.
And do you participate as well in these fights for land preservation and Sami rights?
As a young Sami person, we're all a part of this spreading of information, and I hope that everyone shares this engagement in these cases where it's where these people are experiencing unjustness. So there haven't been, to my knowledge, any protests or uprisings in the larger community, but only in being here and showing their art, it's a way of fighting. It's a way of spreading information, which is one of the most powerful things you can do to make people aware of what is happening. And in this last piece, you can see that Anders Sunna himself has burned this. You cannot see that he has burned it, but it is burned, and he did it himself. For many that come here, they believe that they have given up, that they're a family who has fallen, but it represents resilience, and it empowers the future generations to keep fighting. It's a sign of hope for the future, because fire can be an element of rebirth. Mm. So we are at the Sami Pavilion that used to be, or usually is, the Nordic Pavilion of Norway, Sweden and Finland. But this year is a historic event. It's the first time that there is an indigenous Sami takeover, and where, as you saw in the art, the Sami people gets to be here and showcase their art, which is a powerful art, and it criticizes these countries for the colonization that has been going on and is still, as you can see, there are processes that might be quite secret, that go under the radar, but here they are out in the open, and the world gets to see it. We have around 1,000 and 2,000 visitors every day in the pavilion. And here we have something that's not a part of the art.
Well, maybe it is.
But it is, in a way.
The pavilions here in the Biennale are organized by states and countries. And as a Sami people, we are a nation with no country. We are a borderless people, and we wanted to show that also in the Sami pavilion. So here you can see this birch box hiding the country's names, or the name of the countries, because behind it you can see the states, like Norway and Sweden.
Oh wow, I didn't know that was behind here.
They wanted to take down those letters, but they were not allowed. So they were thinking, what can we do? We cannot have them standing there representing the pavilion. So they came up with this solution which turned into a statement.
And what does the statement say, or what does this birch bark here mean?
That we are one people, not divided in this nation, these states. So that is an important message for the world as well.
Mm-hmm. Because a lot of places, the world works with borders. We need to have this these signs of who are we, and like these very specific divide or yes, but here we are a people who
are split into four countries, Russia as well. So that's the like the point, to just be this element of contrast mm-hmm. In this Biennale, where the pavilions are organized in states.
We are all part of one world, even if we have borders to our countries, which is also this new wave of the climate, the awareness of climate, of the climate crisis, where we all live in the same world, and borders will not help us in this fight. We all live in the same world, and we all need to protect it equally. And the Sámi way of life is in harmony with each creature. We are not above. We are all equal.
Well, we just had a really wonderful tour of the Sámi Pavilion at the Biennale Arte 2022 in Venice, Italy. And I just really want to thank you from the bottom of my heart on behalf of the Pacific Sámi Searvi, on behalf of Sámi Americans in the United States. All of you two. This is such a gift. It really is a gift, because there are many of us who maybe wanted to come but could not. It's a long journey, as you both know. And I'm just really happy to be able to meet you both, and to be able to understand some of the art and the history and the culture that's here in the pavilion. One thing that I learned was that this installation is new this year, so the Biennale has been happening for over 100 years, and this has been historically known as the Nordic Pavilion. But this year in 2022 is the first time that it has been renamed and redesignated as the Sámi Pavilion. And as Mayan mentioned, it's sort of a Sámi takeover of the pavilion. And so it's really wonderful to see this art here in an open air space under the natural light of day, where, as Mayan mentioned, thousands and thousands of people are coming to enjoy the art and learn more about Sámi culture, Sámi history, Sámi life. So thank you. Thank you so much for offering this time and this space. What a gift. It really is truly a gift. And I also learned that Mayan is possibly going to be traveling to Seattle at some point soon. So for all of you Sámi Americans on the west coast of the United States, we look forward to the possibility of having you in Seattle and getting to know you better and learning more about you as well.
I'm very, very excited, and I was so excited to learn that there is this Saturday. So I'm so excited to come and see and get to know all of you.
Yeah, well, we hope you'll become a member of the Pacific yes. Sámi Searvi as well, because she's a native Sámi speaker, North Sámi speaker, so we have a lot to learn from you as well.
Exciting future.
Yeah, yeah. And Dalamari, maybe when we visit Norway, then the Norwegian side of Sápmi, maybe we can meet again.
Yeah, I invite you all to come to visit Kautokeino, especially in Easter, when we have the Sámi Easter festivals in our village. So it's really recommended to visit, so I hope you
hope I will see you all again.
Thank you. And when is the Sámi Easter Festival?
Next year, it's in start of April. I don't remember the dates exactly, but in start of April.
April of 2023, the Sámi Easter Festival in Kautokeino?
Yes.
Okay.
It's always in Easter, so it changes, but it's always those Easter days.
Okay.
So
you can plan years ahead.
Yeah.
Lovely, lovely. Is there a website where Sámi Americans can go to learn more, to support the artist, to support history and culture, to be more involved with Sámis in Sápmi? Is there a place that we can go to continue our journeys?
First of all, the Sámi Pavillion has their own page if you want to know the art. Or you can look up the artists themselves. They have their own things going on as well outside this pavilion. And we will give you links. If you have any specific information you want, or because there is a lot out there, so
there are parliaments and Sámi organizations, and there are history organizations, and there are a lot of festivals, so there are a lot of information out there.
And we have the Sámi pathfinders that we used to be. That's why we are here. What we used to travel around in Norway, giving talks and lectures about the Sámi culture. So maybe that would be a possibility to contact them and say, hey, this year maybe you can do a trip here to the Pacific Sámi Saturday.
Yeah, that would be great. We would love to host Pathfinders in the Seattle area. That would be incredible, actually. Oh, well, I feel just a heart full of gratitude for your time, for your expertise. You've traveled a long way to be here at the Biennale, and I just feel so lucky that we were here at the same time in the same space and could have this conversation. So on behalf of the Pacific Sámi Searvi, all of you two, for all that you do and the hard work that you put in, we appreciate you, we appreciate and value the culture, and we hope to continue to build relationship over time and to continue to learn more.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.